Welcome back to the second section of the 2022 colloquium. Our next presenter, Sarah Praskievicz, Department of Geography, Environment, and Sustainability in the University of North Carolina, Greensboro, fog interception in spruce-fir forests of Great Smoky Mountains National Park.
Okay, thank you. So it's a beautiful day to be talking about fog. So what is fog interception? In order to understand that, we have to look at the water budget for a forest. So what are the kind of pathways that water can take as it moves through a vegetation canopy? So the main input of water is precipitation. Some of that precipitation can hit the ground directly. And from there, it can either evaporate back to the atmosphere, it can infiltrate into the soil, or it can generate surface runoff. The infiltrated water can in turn either percolate down into groundwater, flow back to the surface as runoff, or be taken up through the roots of vegetation and return to the atmosphere ultimately through transpiration. However, because the vegetation is a barrier between the atmosphere and the ground, some of the incoming precipitation does not fall to the ground, but instead is captured or intercepted by the vegetation canopy. So this is water that collects on the leaves and branches of the vegetation. And that intercepted water, some of it will evaporate from the vegetation surfaces before it ever has the chance to make its way to the ground, while the rest will ultimately make its way to the ground after a delay, either through the process of throughfall, which is water that drips off of the vegetation surfaces to the ground, or stem flow, which is water that flows down the tree trunks. So for rainfall interception, that is always a loss from the perspective of the watershed, because it is water that would otherwise make it to the ground if the vegetation was not there, but instead is intercepted and, you know, partially evaporated away before it has the chance to contribute to the water budget. Fog interception is a different story, because fog is a, you know, cloud that has its base near the ground. And like all clouds, fog is made up of tiny water droplets that are too small and light to fall to the ground. So that's why they remain suspended in the air. But if those suspended water droplets encounter a vegetation surface, they can collect on those vegetation surfaces. And just like other intercepted water, some of that intercepted fog water will evaporate from the vegetation surfaces, but some of it will ultimately make its way to the ground via throughfall and stem flow. So for this reason, fog interception is a gain from the perspective of the watershed, because it represents an additional input of water. This is water that would not otherwise be available for soil moisture and stream flow if those vegetation surfaces were not there to intercept that fog water. So we know that fog interception is a significant portion of the water budget in certain environments. As you would expect, these are mostly environments with high amounts of fog. The kind of classic example are the tropical cloud forests that are found in tropical montane environments like in Costa Rica. Another interesting example is coastal deserts like the margins of the Atacama Desert in Chile, where it's extremely dry. There's almost never any measurable rainfall, but there is high fog frequency because of a cold ocean current. So basically the vegetation that grows in this environment is supported almost entirely by fog interception rather than by rainfall. For a temperate kind of example, we can look to the coast redwoods of California, where again, the rainfall amounts during the growing season are quite low, but there is high fog frequency, again, due to a cold ocean current. So it's, you know, believed that the redwoods wouldn't be able to grow in this environment if it were not for the additional inputs of water that they get from fog interception. So we have good reason to believe that the Smokies are another environment in which fog interception can make up a substantial portion of the water budget. That's because it is a very foggy place. So it's, you know, called the Smokies because of the fog and haze that often hangs over the mountains that appears like smoke. So there's different fog processes that are common in the Smokies. So many mornings you'll see radiation fog down in the valleys. This forms when overnight the ground gets cold and cools the layer of air above it, causing it to become saturated. We also see frequent orographic or upslope fog along the mountain peaks, where moist air is being forced to rise over the mountains and becoming saturated. If we look at the fog climatology of the US, the Southern Appalachians are one of several kind of like fog hotspots when we look at the data at an annual timescale. However, where the Southern Appalachians really stick out is if we look at the summer fog frequency. So unlike other like foggy places in the US, the fog frequency of the Smokies and the Southern Appalachians in general is actually highest in the summer. And that is because it's during the summer that we have the dominance of maritime tropical air masses. So these very humid air masses that are forced to rise up over the mountains, and it doesn't take much cooling for them to become saturated because they contain so much moisture. So the specific area of the park that we expect to be most affected by fog interception is the spruce-fir forest found in the highest elevations of the park, above about 1,700 meters. These forests are a relic of the last ice age. So back when there was, you know, the last glacial maximum and temperatures were much colder, this forest type would have been widespread throughout the southeast. But then as the climate warmed, as we were coming out of the ice age, most of that forest was replaced by hardwood species. So it's just in these, a few isolated areas in the highest elevations of the Southern Appalachians where this forest type has remained. And the largest Southern Appalachian spruce fir forest is found in the Smokies. So this is a forest that is dominated by two species, red spruce and Fraser fir, and it is an endangered ecosystem. One of the biggest threats is the invasive insect, the balsam woolly adelgid, which kills Fraser fir trees. As the firs die off, that also leaves openings in the canopy that leaves the other trees, including the spruces, more vulnerable to wind throw. Both species are also negatively impacted by air pollution and acid rain. And there's also potential that as climate is warming, conditions at higher elevations may become more favorable for northern hardwoods, which is the next vegetation zone down. So there could potentially be encroachment of the hardwoods into areas formerly occupied by spruce and fir. So previous research has found that fog interception is a major process in spruce fir forests of the Southern Appalachians. So this 1982 paper by Smathers, for example, installed rain gauges at four sites in the Southern Appalachians. And some of those rain gauges had fog interceptors attached. So basically these mesh screens that collect fog, and then that fog water drips down into the rain gauges. So then they can look at the rainfall from the rain gauges alone and the additional water that is contributed by fog interception. And they found that in some cases, the amount of water availability was almost doubled when you include this intercepted fog water. But what we can't tell from studies like this is whether there are differences among tree species in their effectiveness in fog interception, because it's not looking at the actual fog water that's intercepted by the trees, but just kind of like these open sites where these screens are installed to intercept any fog that is present. And we have reason to believe that there may be interspecific differences in fog interception, specifically between spruce and fir versus the northern hardwoods. So there's physiological differences that would lead us to believe that spruce and fir might be more effective fog interceptors than hardwoods. First of all, spruce and fir are evergreens. Most of the hardwood trees are deciduous, so the spruce and fir have their leaves available for interception year-round. The needle leaf trees like spruce and fir also have a greater surface area of leaves because they have lots of tiny little leaves instead of, you know, fewer larger leaves. And then also the branching structure of conifers may allow fog to sort of penetrate the vegetation canopy more easily. So what we were trying to investigate in this research is how fog interception differs between spruce and fir versus northern hardwoods in the park. And the kind of motivation for looking at this is considering how the vegetation water balance might change if there's widespread encroachment of hardwoods into the spruce fir zone. So if there is a greater fog interception ability for spruce and fir, then is that significant enough that it would affect the overall water budget if there's more hardwoods moving to higher elevations? And then kind of the flip side of that is, can fog interception buffer spruce and fir against climate change if conditions become drier and hotter during the growing season in the future, but fog frequency remains unchanged, then perhaps fog interception, if it is a significant component of the water budget, can help spruce and fir become more resilient against those changes. So we set up three study sites in the high elevations of the park. So the first site is near the summit of Klingman's Dome at over 2000 meters elevation. So this is well within the spruce fir zone with no hardwoods present. The second site, Mount Collins, near the Mount Collins trail shelter, and Nolan Divide, the third site in the Nolan Divide experimental watershed. These were both just over 1700 meters elevation, kind of at the lower limit of the spruce fir zone. So this was a mixed forest with both spruce fir and hardwoods present. Across the three sites, we set up 9 rain gauges. These are electronically recording tipping bucket rain gauges. So we installed 3 out in the open. And these open site gauges are meant to measure the above canopy rainfall. We also installed 6 gauges beneath the canopy of individual trees of different species. So we put 2 under fir trees, 2 under spruce, and 2 under birch, which was our representative northern hardwood species. All of the gauges within a single site were within a couple hundred meters of each other, so we can assume that the microclimatic conditions were pretty similar within each site. We installed the rain gauges in May of 2021 and took them down in November before the snowfall. And during the time that they were in operation, either our field crew or a volunteer, trained volunteer, would check on the gauges every 2 to 4 weeks to download the data, change batteries if needed, and make sure that any debris was cleared out. So the way that we can use this setup to estimate fog interception is the high temporal frequency of recording that these rain gauges have. So they can record at frequencies of up to 1 minute. So at the open site gauge, all that's going into the gauge is rainfall, and the only thing that's leaving it is evaporation, which we can assume to be minimal because the gauges are designed to have negligible evaporative losses. At the beneath canopy gauges, one input is rainfall, and the only things that are going out are ET and stem flow, which is not being captured by the gauges, but again, we can ignore that because previous studies have shown that stem flow is generally a much smaller component of the vegetation water balance than through fall. So in addition to rainfall, the other sources of water going into the beneath canopy gauges are rainfall through fall, so when it rains and then later drips into the gauge, and also fog interception gain, which is the thing that we are interested in measuring. So the way we differentiate these is by looking for water inputs into the beneath canopy gauges at times when it is not raining, so that is controlling for direct rainfall, and has not rained recently, so that's controlling for rainfall through fall. And by recently, so far what we've used is a 3-hour time period preceding what we identify as a potential fog interception event. So if there's rain going into one of the beneath canopy gauges, it is not currently raining and it has not rained in the last 3 hours, we are identifying that as a potential fog interception event. So looking at just the total water inputs into the different gauges, we can see a couple of big spikes associated with Tropical Storm Fred and Ida in August and September, where there was nearly 5 inches of rainfall going into some of the gauges. I do want to point out that there's, due to equipment malfunctions, 2 periods of missing data. So at the Mount Collins open site, we have missing data for most of September. And so we are not calculating fog interception for Mount Collins at all during that time period. And then for the Mount Collins spruce site, we also had about a 3-week period of missing data in July and August. So we can't calculate fog interception for spruce during that time period. But if we look at the overall water inputs, so again, Mount Collins is kind of an outlier here, lower rainfall amounts because of those periods of missing data. But if we look at the 2 sites that had continuous data records, Klingman's Dome and Nolan Divide both had higher inputs into the open site gauge compared to the beneath canopy gauges, which is what we expect. So we can calculate our relative rainfall interception losses, which range between 11% to 57% for the different tree species. But what we're really interested in is the fog interception events. So again, that is based on looking at the differences in timing of water inputs into the open site versus the beneath canopy gauges. So our initial analysis has revealed anywhere between 47 to 82 potential fog interception events for our different sites, making up 24 to 116 total millimeters of fog interception. Just a couple of things to point out. So the number of fog interception events seems to be highest at Klingman's Dome, which is the highest elevation site. So we would therefore expect the highest fog frequency there. When we look at the amounts of fog interception at both sites, it was lowest for birch, so significantly lower for birch at Nolan Divide, but at Mount Collins, it seemed to be pretty similar among the different species. We think that that may be in part because of some data quality issues at Mount Collins. This site was not as open as the other two. So it's possible that we are over detecting fog interception events at Mount Collins, and we're going to experiment with different thresholds for identifying events in order to try to solve those data quality issues. So we did look at the webcam at Klingman's Dome to try to verify some of these fog interception events. And the majority of times when there was a daylight event that was identified as a potential fog interception event, it was indeed foggy at Klingman's Dome. So that gives us some confidence that this method is effective for identifying these events. In terms of the timing of events, for the most part, July and August had the majority of potential fog interception events, which is what we'd expect given that's the height of the summer with the dominance of these maritime tropical air masses. Kind of the main takeaway here is looking at our preliminary analysis of fog interception gain. And again, this is preliminary because we're still experimenting with thresholds to try to identify as reliably as we can what the interception events are before we would go on and do any inferential statistics. So just looking at this from a descriptive statistics perspective at this point. We see basically as low as 2 to 6% for Klingman's Dome and Nolan Divide, with the lowest being the birch at Nolan's Divide. Whereas it's 21 to 23% for the various species at Mount Collins. And again, part of this may be that we had that long period of missing data in September when there were big precipitation events. So part of this may be that we're underestimating the total precipitation inputs into Mount Collins. So main takeaway is just that our potential fog interception gains range from 2 to 23%, with the higher end probably being an overestimate. This is much lower than the Smathers estimate of 86 to 94%. And that's probably because of canopy storage. So as opposed to using just simple fog collectors where the rain is then immediately dripping down into the gauge, This method is accounting for canopy storage and losses from the canopy due to ET. So we don't yet have the statistical analysis to support the interspecific differences in fog interception, but we're going to continue to work on that. So I'd like to acknowledge funding sources, fieldwork, access and logistics, and our crew of field assistants. And I'll be happy to take a question or two if there's time. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. We're right up against it, but if people have questions, if you could write them in the chat, I believe Sarah ought to be able to answer them directly there.